So I know I don't have a lot of time to talk. So let me just sort of get right smack into the middle of this. I was asked to talk about urban and transportation related things, but I'll sort of talk a little bit more broadly. We are a think tank based in Sri Lanka. History of, you know, we're about 12 years old, but very much in the sort of ICT policy and regulation space. But then we started looking at how can ICTs be used in other sectors, so agriculture was one of those. And then since 2012, we've been working on big data, trying to use that for specific developmental policy domains. But the work is only in Sri Lanka and a little bit in Bangladesh. So these are some problems of interest to us. Cities very much, you know, we understand that given the region that we are located in, large amounts of the population is in the cities, and they're growing at a tremendous rate, which is, you know, not in the most planned fashion. So what can we do in that scenario when there's limited planning and limited sensor data that we can bring to bear? So primarily what we're thinking of is using data from mobile operators as a proxy, as human sensors for a lot of different things. These are the four areas of the research practice that I lead that it looks at. One is conducting the analytics for answering specific problems in different domains or to develop insights that are fed into specialists working in these domains. Deeply engaging with the policymakers. We actually, in a way, come from the other side, not so much from the analysis side, but given our historical linkages with policymakers and working in that space, trying to work with them and the symbolic environment, so not just a policymaker, but, you know, in that specialist, the domain of transportation, which can be broadly defined. Also studying the impacts of it for on society, privacy, marginalization, competition issues. So we do have sort of our founder is a lawyer as well. So you know that's the area that we sort of look at quite a bit, just because it's also an area that sort of can counter some of the work that we are doing in terms of trying to limit the impact. And we want to sort of bring evidence grounded in reality into that discourse on a regional level. So that, for example, we've convened with sort of regulators in the region. We sort of talk to them on a regular basis, also with ITU and the related bodies in the regional APT, for example, in trying to make access to telecom data more easier for others in the region. And developing guidelines. So I'll just give you some examples of what we're doing with CDR data. Everyone knows what CDR data is. So this is essentially your metadata every time you use your phone. So when you make a call, receive a call, send an SMS, receive an SMS, initiate an internet session, do a reload, these get automatically created in the network that the operators have this data. This is metadata, so there's no actual content. And we've got basically for about half the population of Sri Lanka, 10 million plus people's sort of multiple years records, pseudonymized, so we don't know who they are, we don't know demographics, we don't know economics, it's just a mass of people, people's data. So we're using that for a variety of things, trying to get more granular and high frequency estimates of population density, understanding changes in population density, the diurnal cycles, circadian rhythms of people moving into and out of cities, in terms of these traces that they leave behind. And these do have implications, for example, this in terms of transport. What you see here is, this is Colombo City, and the picture shows, you know, the relative density of a place relative to midnight. So what it is like at 6:30, 12:30, 6:30 in the evening. And so this is a weekend, weekday. So during the weekday noon, that's when you have sort of, you know, Colombo City's population density is highly saturated. And, you know, the people are generally coming from the regions outside the city. So you sort of have a sense of where people are coming from, what the population sort of hotspots are, and you can start to think, use this also as a way to understand cities. There's this thing about whether cities are monocentric, polycentric, what does that mean for urban planning? This is some of that, that insights that inform that debate. Also, when you think about what should the administrative boundary, what should the limits of the city be? Colombo is actually a very small city compared to India, Indian cities. It's, we are, technically the population is 550,000. But daytime population is excess of 1.5 million. So you can start to think they all bear, they're all imposing costs on the city that aren't recovered, from transportation to garbage collection, et cetera. So what should be the optimal makeup of cities? What should the boundaries be? And you can start to play around with interesting sort of possibilities that you can do with policymakers about what should be the makeup of the city, where you can start to increase the boundaries to a certain manageable population that is still manageable in terms of services that can be delivered to them. So we sort of so engage with policymakers on issues like this. On transportation, for example, we are sort of trying to think, this is essentially what we do is because of all the traces that people leave behind, we can construct a network of mobility, and we are doing modularity optimization to sort of do some partitioning of this. And so what essentially this means is that this is, each colored region is a region where the density of travel within it is greater than across. And you can think of this being plugged into last mile solutions, right? If you have the bus that's coming from point A to point B, where should the, this would be where the three-wheeler associations you might want to have. You can think more broadly and think about sort of localized transport schemes for park and ride options based on where people start and where people end up. We are also, for example, studying the impact of new infrastructure. This is work that I do with Joshua Blumenstock from the University of California, UC Berkeley, where we are looking at developing new measures of trying to understand the impact of new infrastructure on mobility, and by extension, understanding the welfare impacts on the population over time. Because if we can have this data, we can understand its short-term, medium-term, long-term impacts. This is something that we're doing right now. The fieldwork just got completed. We don't have a lot of intelligence about this 10 million plus people. We don't know gender, we don't know economics, we don't know demographics. So what we're trying to do is an ideal scenario where we'd work with the operators to do phone surveys through which we can build a good training data set. But that's a little difficult to accomplish. So we're doing a slightly next best solution is sort of a parallel activity where we've done used a purposive sample and installed, found people with mobile phones, make sure there's enough coverage of gender, age, and economics, socioeconomics level that they are in, and have an app that captures their cell phone behavior, as well as, you know, we do a survey on top, we're capturing GPS logs as well from these smartphones. But in order to build understanding for transportation policy, we are asking questions every so often. So between the time of 6 a.m. to 9 p.m., we are asking every hour on the hour questions like, you know, where are you? What are you doing? Where are you, if you're going, where are you going to? And what form of transport you're using? Through which we can sort of, we'll basically leverage this as a training data to understand the mass of data that we have on the other side with the cell phone records. But again, you know, this data is sparse. It's not great for understanding traffic conditions. There's VLR data, which is good, but that's not kept for very long in the networks. It doesn't give you very fine temporal resolution. So we're trying to develop algorithms to do CCTV footage, working with the police department there. Also trying to understand, for example, based on the circadian rhythms of people connected to base station, can we again identify regions of high economic activity and sort of understand whether, you know, on the highly residential to highly commercial spectrum of areas. But that is not good enough. So we are also looking at satellite imagery to understand urban space a lot more. That's more the idea being that, you know, trying to have, you can make all these grand plans and visions of what your city should be in 20, 30 years, but when you don't know what's actually happening on the ground, it's kind of pointless. So, but we can also leverage mobility. This is basically using an origin-constrained gravity model to develop new proxy indicators of economic activity. These track very well with nighttime lights, but they have the added advantage that, you know, this is at a finer temporal resolution. You can think about doing this weekly. This is a great measure of understanding on a very localized basis. So, like yesterday, we were talking about regions at a district level, but here you can potentially go down even further down. So this is work in progress that we're doing, and we're feeding into the sort of official statistics. These are the sort of broad implications of this work that we're working with different domains, so urban and transportation policy, epidemiology unit on understanding disease propagation. So that's in a brief the kind of work that we're doing. Thank you.
A quick question. How closely are you working with the government? Does it matter, these policy recommendations?
So when we started this, there was absolutely no demand. We sort of were under the radar by purpose because we didn't know. We had to figure out all the implications. So we didn't talk about it for a good year and a half, and it took about a year to negotiate the data. So initially, I would have, as I was saying to some of you, I was like a Jehovah's Witness going door to door, have you heard the good word of big data? But now it's more like they will give us calls. We are doing X, Y, and Z. So there was a huge amount of policy enlightenment work in the beginning, doing workshops, doing meetings, to tell them the different ways of, you know, that you can use this for. So now it's at different levels. So it's not always that the senior person knows, a policymaker knows all the interactions that their department is having with us. So large amount, but there's health, for example, is more tricky. We're still working with them. We're working with the police department. But you know, that's a long engagement of having chai pani for a long periods of time. Yeah.